Thank you all very much for coming. It looks like we have a great turnout. I'm Sarah Pritchard, I'm the Dean of Libraries, and we're especially pleased to be hosting this component of a whole series of events today and tomorrow, and by coincidence also coming right on the heels of the CIC's conference in Nebraska on digital humanities, which we know is a problematic phrase, but I use it because it's short. The humanities in a digital age, which is a much better conveying, that's the title for our panel here this afternoon. So we have really a wonderfully distinguished panel and group of guests, and my thanks to Martin Muller for really, a year ago, I think, starting to organize this and work with a whole series of campus constituencies, certainly not just the library, but many of the departments in Weinberg College and across campus and academic and research technologies to continue our interest in these many issues. And so I think the initiatives specifically that we're talking about, but also in general over the last several years of sponsoring events related to the digital humanities work, really have fostered a lot of collaborations. This is exact phrasing from, I think, one of Tara's emails, fostering new collaborations among humanities centers, university presses, archives, scholarly societies, and we would add an even greater variety of academic departments, these topics. And our speakers have articulated some very broad questions around issues such as the audience problem in the humanities, changing ways of interacting with readers, changing modes of publication, changing practices in peer review, changing ways of handling and identifying scholarly evidence in a digital environment. So they will each say a few words about their own work and their thoughts on these issues. And initially, each person will speak for a fairly short amount of time, 5 or 10 minutes, on their work and kind of a start-off question: where do humanists have the most scope for action as our traditional practices migrate to digital platforms? Then after all three of our speakers speak to these issues, we hope to have a very interactive roundtable discussion where I will join the group. We will open it up to questions from the audience. We have some additional questions ourselves to prime the speakers. We think there will be no shortage of questions. But that is to say, we very much want a participatory exchange and not just on and on and on for an hour and a half. And of course not, because I think we do have refreshments at the end of the hour. I wasn't sure what if there was an end point. I mean, we do have to be done before midnight. But, so I will introduce all three of our speakers now, and then we will just proceed straight through. And this is the order in which they'll speak. We have Kathleen Fitzpatrick, who is the Director of Scholarly Communication at the Modern Language Association. She's on leave from a position as Professor of Media Studies at Pomona College in Claremont, California. She's the author of Planned Obsolescence, Publishing Technology and the Future of the Academy, that just came out last year. And a few years earlier, The Anxiety of Obsolescence, the American Novel in the Age of Television. She's also the co-founder of the digital scholarly network called Media Commons. After Kathleen, we'll speak Tara McPherson, who is the Associate Professor of Gender and Critical Studies at the University of Southern California School of Cinematic Arts, and she's co-director of USC's Center for Transformative Scholarship. She wrote a very award-winning book in 2003 called Reconstructing Dixie, Race, Gender, and Nostalgia in the Imagined South, and is co-editor of Hop on Pop. It almost sounds like a Dr. Seuss book, I'm sorry. Hop on Pop, The Politics and Pleasures of Popular Culture, and the editor of Digital Youth, Innovation, and the Unexpected, which is part of a series from the MacArthur Foundation on digital media and learning. She's the founding editor of Vectors, which is a multimedia peer-reviewed journal hosted at USC. Catherine Rowe is the chair of the Department of English at Bryn Mawr College, lest you think we were having all West Coast people, and a leader in the Tri-Colleges Digital Humanities Initiative, which is a research and teaching collaboration of Bryn Mawr, Haverford, and Swarthmore, who had, by the way, a very interesting semi-merged, semi-independent library system. So they do a lot of venturesome collaborations at the Tri-Colleges. Catherine is the author of Dead Hands, Fictions of Agency, Renaissance to Modern, and the co-author of New Wave Shakespeare on Screen. And she has just developed two iPad apps for Shakespeare, one for social reading and one that is scripting tools. So let me turn now first to Kathleen. As I said, each speaker will go in turn, and then I will moderate a larger group of questions. So we will start out by thinking about where do humanists have the most scope for action? Thank you.
Thank you. I'm just going to show a few things as I talk to you. So I've been working since 2006 on the development of Media Commons, which is a digital scholarly network that's aimed at folks who are working in the field of media studies. And this project came about for a number of different reasons. One of them, as I was talking about earlier today, this got started in part because I was trying to publish that first book, The Anxiety of Obsolescence, and was running into the wall of the precarious financial situation of academic publishing today. I started thinking about what it would be to start an online scholarly press, something that would be entirely community organized and entirely digital and entirely what you see. And in the context of some conversations leading up to the development of Media Commons, we began to think less about a digital scholarly press, and instead what it would be to form a network of scholars that were working with one another and doing different kinds of work that weren't necessarily book-length or article-length texts, but that were working in new kinds of networked ways at a range of weights and time signatures for new forms of scholarship. And so, we have a series of projects at Media Commons, the oldest of which is In Media Res, which is a project in which 5 days a week, a scholar will post a very brief media clip with an opening commentary that's equally brief, that's just designed to sort of open up a conversation. These are clustered together in theme weeks of five that are together supposed to create a complex portrait of something that's going on in the media right now. So obviously this is David Milch Week that has just gotten started. We have a second project entitled The New Everyday, which is thinking at slightly greater length about the ways that the new forms of mediation by which we are constantly surrounded and through which we are constantly defined are affecting our understanding of the circumstances in which we live. And these texts, Nick Mirzov, who is the coordinating editor of The New Everyday, thinks about this as being an experiment in middle state publishing, right? That these are texts that are slightly longer and more developed than the blog post, but not quite as sealed into fixity as the journal article. So these are also likewise clustered into groups of authors who are working together on some particular kind of topic, as are the authors who are working on the project Alt Academy, which is a cluster of folks who are in alternative academic careers and really thinking about what the future of the non-teaching, non-faculty, but nonetheless academic PhD might be. So there's a whole lot to explore in all of these projects. Alongside all of this, we're also, though, still thinking about those longer format texts and ways that they might be changed by this online environment. And so Media Commons Press has been conducting a series of experiments in open review and in other modes of conveying long texts for open discussion within a socially networked space. And it was in the process of sort of starting up this network that I started doing a bunch of writing about these new modes of scholarly communication and sort of woke up one day and realized that all of this writing went together And so, you know, hence the book that came out in November. We actually posted the, we meaning me and NYU Press, from whom the book has come out, posted the entirety of the draft manuscript on the Media Commons Press website in September 2009, sort of deciding to walk the walk in a certain way, and attempting to see whether the kinds of open review processes that the text argues for actually did the text itself some good. So it was a productive process of discussion, and it allowed me to see a whole lot of things about the manuscript and about the community that the manuscript was interacting with that I wouldn't have gotten an opportunity to see otherwise. The book did come out this November in print in a revised form. And it's you know, NYU is thrilled to see that it's actually doing quite well in terms of sales, that this whole experiment online seems to have generated buzz rather than cannibalizing sales, which, you know, they're extremely happy about. But one unintended consequence of this project is that, you know, I do all this writing in which I'm thinking, as a scholar does, about the future of scholarly communication, and I'm pushing envelopes, and I'm, you know, making lots of bold claims. And next thing I know, I'm being asked by the Modern Language Association to see if these ideas actually work. So I'm now in this other job as the director of scholarly communication, in which I'm trying to help the organization think through what the future of communication within the organization is going to be. And, you know, it's an extremely exciting position, and it's not so mildly terrifying as well, as, you know, it's not often that one is asked to actually take one's ideas and see if they work. But the kinds of things that we're thinking about in the office have to do with the ways that the publishing program of a large scholarly society will inevitably change as our membership moves increasingly online. We're engaged in the process, of course, as most organizations are, of rethinking our traditional publications, how they need to be distributed online, in what formats, on what platforms, to whom, and so forth. But we're also thinking pretty seriously about the ways that we need to support and facilitate the new kinds of work that are being done by our members in forms that exceed the traditional boundaries of the book. And so, literally just before I walked in the room, we announced that we have received a grant from the Mellon Foundation to support our end of the development of a network called MLA Commons that is going to be a way of supporting and facilitating pretty robust member-to-member communication and experimentation on a range of levels amongst members of the MLA. And that we're hoping will also enable the MLA to reach out to other scholarly societies and sort of make connections across those disciplinary bounds as well. And in this project, we're collaborating with the CUNY Academic Commons folks, who have spent a lot of time developing what is a really fantastic and an extremely user-friendly platform for this kind of member-to-member communication. So we're really thrilled and extremely happy to have, you know, their support as we go forward with this. So what is it that we have to help us rethink this moment in the humanities is mostly a lot of questions and a lot of room for experimentation. But also a lot of support from the scholarly society for the kinds of experimentation that its members are going to be engaging in as we go forward. So let me start that back up, and I will pass it on to Tara.
And thanks to Martin and to Holly and everybody from the library, Claire. You know, it takes a lot of people to kind of organize a day-long event like this, and I'm very appreciative.
So some of you I recognize from the talk earlier today, and the slides will look very familiar as a mode of remix, right? But I'm going to take them in a slightly different direction today. And I thought in answering the kind of question posed, I would focus in particularly on some possibilities around scholarly publishing. So in case you were nervous, my first proposition for the day
is that books will endure. Right? These are not a set of binary either-or questions that, you know, the kind of renegade digital humanities scholars are going to erupt onto the scene and we will see the withering and death of the print book. In fact, some of the leading scholars of the digital humanities do things like print books that, you know, in very short order go into second runs, right? So there is, you know, a very robust tradition of print monographs Books are a technology that work very well for a particular kind of linear long-form argument, right? The process of creating a monograph produces for the scholar a kind of winnowing effect in which we move through a variety of materials and learn both to synthesize and produce a kind of order. And those are very important scholarly skill sets, methodologies, and we want those to endure, right? They're also very durable objects, right, that will last longer than any of the digital things we're showing you today, right? So those things are important and good things to remember. They're lovely, they're tactile, sometimes they have really interesting smells that digital objects rarely have, right? I prefer to take these in the bath so that I don't electrocute myself, right? You know, they're kind of robust things that will last. But books should also expand, right? I think we're in a moment in which it behooves humanities scholars to think about many questions, including our potential audiences. And books expanding will be an important way that we will undertake that work. In some ways, they'll expand fairly comfortably and familiarly, right? So, I think my reading, particularly of novels, has increased exponentially since my purchase of a Kindle a few years ago because of its portability and the ease with which I could read on the plane. And this is not a destabilizing device. You know, my 75-year-old parents read avidly on Kindles and it doesn't perplex them, right? They know how to do that, right? We will see these applications for Kindles and iPads stretch in really interesting ways, one of which you'll see very shortly from Professor Rowe, right? And part of that set of expansions will be to push toward multimodal, mini-sensory networked engagements that allow text to exist but unfold into different ecologies and environments. So this I'm not going to talk much about, but it's done on a platform called Scalar that the software lab I run at USC that I have no training to run. You too can run a software lab if you spend a little effort, right? The platform is a kind of authoring environment to do networked long-form scholarship that includes rich digital materials in a variety of ways. What I want to say about in particular today is the way in which it allows us to marshal our scholarly evidence in new ways. For as film scholars, we've often described absent objects in our print work, you know, the field that I come from. You spend a lot of the kind of labor of your work describing the object that's not there in your print work, right? And I think new standards of evidence and possibility begin to emerge when the missing object is visualized in the publication in new ways. And of course, it also opens up to new forms of community and communication. Some of the ways books will expand won't look like books at all. They'll be very wacky and often quite inviting. This is a project that predates the iPad, but had a kind of iPad sensibility, I think, in its design. It's by the feminist scholar Minu Moalem, who's a transnational postcolonial scholar, who's working on a book on the Persian carpet in the international imaginary. And this book allows you to pursue some of her text and ideas in a very tactile way. So if you work with this piece on your computer with your mouse or your touchscreen, you're actually moving the threads around in particular ways. And when we did this a few years ago, it was very wacky, and now it almost seems, you know, painfully familiar if you stroke your iPad very often, right? So gesture, tactility, different levels of sound and visuality will really kind of shape us into, will really push us toward new kinds of books. As we pursue the new forms of institutions that many scholars, I think on a national level, like Kathy Davidson, as well as my peers on the panel, are encouraging us to build, we must ask ourselves why we continue to fetishize print books and even online text above all other forms within the academy. Because they count and can easily be counted, because they are familiar, because they serve our individual careers better than riskier forms of publishing. What audiences do we foreclose by holding on to business as usual? And what aspects of business as usual do we want to preserve? Knowledge should also be, I think, increasingly connected, right? So that scholars are working less and less in isolation and beginning to pool ideas around shared bodies of evidence. I think the sciences are a little bit ahead of us in thinking about these things, but there's also a tendency within the sciences to kind of fetishize big data sets, right? And I think humanities scholars might help us think about what scales we could work across, not only big data, but also very small and intimate and different data, right? And how that might work. Well, not forgetting that, you know, the humanities data sets are some of the largest that we have, right? There are vernacular archives that I think for studies of the visual image will be mined for many, many decades in terms of how we might understand visuality in the 21st century. I think we're beginning to understand what robust combinations of machinic interpretation, where a computer might analyze a set of images in a first pass, and then humans might, you know, refine and supplement and extend that analysis, might look like. A data set like the Shoah Foundation's Oral History Archive is larger than the Sloan Astronomical Survey of the Heavens in terms of raw data, right? There's more here for us to work with than in some of the largest data sets we know. And we've not even begun to figure out how we might really think about visual and oral history in new ways with digital platforms. As humanists, we need to be involved in how databases such as this one, we might call them archives, get implemented and designed. We need to find ways to connect and work across the various archives that motivate us. We need to communicate with our libraries and museums what archives we need most digitized and in what order. And we also need to learn from others in fields that are tangential to the humanities what we might do with this rich repository of digital material once it's available for our use. It's not simply a matter of digitizing material and putting it online or being able to publish a book with 100 images instead of 15, but also to think about how we engage these materials and open up new research methodologies and new research questions that I think we've hardly begun to imagine. Although the work is, you know, unfolding in innovative projects that are imagining new interfaces to existing data sets. So this project actually takes all the data sets that are available from the redlining practices of the insurance industries in the 20s to the 40s and visualizes them with a new map-based interface that lets us understand how particular histories of insurance practices have profoundly shaped the neighborhoods we live in a city like LA today. Other projects begin to redesign the core technologies of databases to allow a more nuanced and sophisticated set of technological parameters that are deeply influenced by humanities kinds of questions. This project in particular looking at how indigenous knowledge systems might be built into archival and database systems. We also want knowledge to be multiple. There's not a set, I think, of either or right answers to how we move forward in the future of publishing, and we need to push beyond the idea that there's a single or correct way to archive data, to construct an interface. Digitized archives and databases allow us multiple experiences at the level of the interface. A scholar just might want to access information quickly and further his own work, again, kind of raiding the archive for their own advantage. But he might also want to reimagine the archive, remix it, invite collaborators to produce pathways through an archive that others might follow. And this work is underway as well in a variety of projects. And, you know, if Holly would like, I'll leave some of these links behind so, you know, that folks can explore these very rich projects in their own way. This is a particularly interesting art group that I think, apropos of a conversation Holly and I had earlier today about the visual artist as a kind of humanities researcher, the open-ended group works with very large digitization projects. So for this project, they've scanned an abandoned factory in Detroit and digitized all that filmic material and produced a very abstract, evocative capacity to move with 3D glasses and a 3D space and an installation through this abandoned factory. And it's very different than the kind of disaster porn that we see like in the New York Times website where you get to look at abandoned buildings and feel like a kind of sense of gladness, it's not your city, and oh, poor Detroit, right? this creates an entirely different emotional and affective register when you put on the 3D glasses and enter what's a fairly abstracted space that's hard to understand. And they're using many of the same tools as scientific visualization, but with a different aesthetic sensibility that I think is actually quite fascinating and something that opens up technology to kind of different engagements with what we might understand to be human history and the human spirit. Knowledge should also be open. Many scholars have begun to write about why we should not be publishing in for-profit university or for-profit presses like Francis and Taylor. The Harvard Faculty Advisory Group released a report today that's been widely tweeted, advising their library to no longer buy expensive subscription packages for journals and encouraging all faculty to seek first open access publishing platforms. And you know, Harvard's not often, forgive me, on the cutting edge of these sorts of changes, right? So that, you know, institutions that are quite valued and prestigious are understanding we need to be moving to more open knowledge systems have released a report like this. I think we should pay attention. We need new kinds of archives that support open access to all kinds of work, not just text, but also to video. And we need new kinds of curatorial practices that allow us to engage materials that are available openly and repackage and recombine them for different audiences. I think knowledge should also be horizontal and collaborative. None of us does our work alone. We work with very talented folks from libraries, from presses, from IT staffs, and the work is deeply collaborative and communal, right? And I think we have capacities to open that up to our students in interesting ways. So science is doing a lot of interesting crowdsourcing. I think you may hear a tiny bit about crowdsourcing from Kathleen. No, Kathleen's not going to tell us it. But there's a lot of kind of crowdsourcing projects afoot, including some here that people are involved in, right? This one's a science one. There are also new modes of learning that I think decenter the professor from the person in the front of the room dispensing knowledge to other modes of collaborative pedagogy. And this is a project that does that across multiple scales, both as a very rich undergraduate experience for knowledge production, but also as a PhD project that pushes beyond the linear print dissertation as the outcome of a doctoral program. So Jeff Watson's dissertation is 300 cards in a box and about a 100-page print object, right? It's a very different paradigm for the future of the dissertation. Scholars are collaborating in ways we might understand to be the public humanities or activism with communities that are not often included in the walls of the ivory tower in ways that I think are quite rich and provocative. And finally, I think we want to push beyond the kind of siloed corrals we've been kind of really shoehorned into in the last 40 years of post-World War II higher education. Our departments are much more fragmented than they've been in the past. They consist of a lot of small niche knowledge production that has disavowed the insights of synthetic knowledge or the generalist. And I think digital platforms allow us to think about how we might have it both ways. Do very fine-grained, specific, close work, but also zoom out in ways to a larger scale that imagines different possibilities. So I think across all these examples, what we're really thinking about is the way the humanist becomes a maker as well as a thinker along many rich registers. And I think that's probably a pretty good introduction.
Okay. I'm Catherine Rowe. I think I want to start by saying that I affirm everything that you've just heard, and I'm going to play out a few of the threads of it in a slightly more concrete way, giving you an example of humanist as maker. From the two scholars on the panel with me, the thing that I have learned over the last 3 years is to be bold. Not something that I think my training as a humanist lent on very hard, although I had terrific preparation for being bold, but I needed some models, and in Kathleen and Tara's work, we've seen some extraordinary boldness in their rethinking the way that we communicate with each other as scholars and as teachers in the field. The different fields that we're in. I trained as a Shakespeare scholar and retrained 5 years ago in media studies and have been spending the last several years exploring new modes of scholarly communication and publication, including publication for popular audiences, crowdsourcing, and new modes of peer review. And in a larger sense, I'm interested in the question of how to solve the audience problem for the humanities. I don't think we have a crisis in our commitments in the humanities, but we may have a crisis in how we communicate those commitments and the populations, how we're heard by the populations coming into our classrooms, their parents, their employers, and so on. The area where it seems to me there's real scope for action involves changing the ways that we interact with readers and designing more boldly than we have in the past for those interactions. I've been experimenting with ebooks in particular, driven in part by a recognition that my students were rapidly shifting towards reading in electronic formats and that I loved it. I've always been a binge reader, and as Tara has said, the e-readers are amazing, addictive resources for binge readers. But you can't take a note in an e-reader. And the DRM situation right now means that you can't really mash up the text. You can't get your hands into the text of an e-reader as we know it now. I also see e-readers as having bought into a kind of Jane Eyre in the window seat model of reading as a solo practice. But those of us who studied the history of the book know that reading is a profoundly social experience. And I felt the lack of that socialness in the e-reader formats that were given to me and my students. And in the margins as the beginning, as the space where thinking first begins. I wanted my students to be able to keep their notes, for example, on their ebooks in a way that they can in print books and can't easily in ebooks for 10 years forward and revisit them. So I spent the last 9 months experimenting with two app development projects. One is a script tool that's in prototype for a Shakespeare play. It's being trialed right now at the American Shakespeare Center in Staunton, Virginia. Designed for actors, dramaturgs, and directors. It's designed for rich note-taking and adjustment, continual adjustment in table work and in rehearsal. All parts of the text are editable. The other app is an app for social reading that was released commercially last week. And this I've developed with a partner, Elliot. Oops, that's not what I want to do. I want to launch it. Let's try that again. I developed with a partner, Elliot Visconti at Notre Dame. We have a two-person company called Luminary Digital Media, a two-professor company, I guess I should say, that's interested in connecting scholars, artists, and teachers directly with readers around texts that are exciting and difficult, and making those texts more accessible. So what would an ebook look like when it was designed by a group of teacher, artists, scholars, and fans? What would we want? We want it, first of all, to be quiet and elegant, as quiet as you want as a reading experience, but dynamic when you want it to be, and then as social as you need it to be. So if what you want to do is take a note, talking and manipulating iPad at the same time is really challenging, you can do that really easily. There's my ghoulish note. Right? Well, we're using Facebook now to share because it's a pretty easy platform to implement right now, but our next development goal is to flip to Moodle and Sakai, the two open source course management platforms, to create fora, to tie into fora that are used in the classroom and elsewhere. You can share and mash up passages. You can collect them in classic, commonplace modes that humanists have used for centuries. So you can grab them, for example, and tag them in groups, export them to a document where you're writing a paper or to a group when you're talking in the classroom. Send it to your class and say, by the way, what's the principle of collection for this set of passages? We have a self-publishing platform that allows users to publish to groups and that collects and curates commentaries from actors, from scholars and from teachers that are tagged to different passages in the play. So this is a critical edition, but a customizable critical edition in the sense that you get to download the commentaries that you're interested in, the ones that you might want. Here's Jennifer Kidd, for example, the actress who plays Miranda for our full text audio, which plays as the text scrolls, commenting on thinking about playing that part. She also plays Ariel, so she talks about doubling the two parts in really interesting ways. And because it's Unicode developed, that gives us the opportunity to publish in a multilingual format, something that I have spent a lot of time over the last couple of years thinking, because a large portion of our undergraduates at Bryn Mawr are non-native speakers, and I'm finding it tremendously exciting to teach in multilingual modes, not something that I was trained to do. In part to address that frustration about DRM, we wrote our co-created content policy to allow you to mash this text up and do what you want with it. So when you do that, when you remake it in some way, you own it. We retain the right to represent it online in the app or in the social space as part of your use agreement with the app, but you retain ownership of that content. See what else I should tell you. Let me give you a sense of what it's like when you get to play around with the design of an app and you get the opportunity to mix in multiple media. I'll let this load. We have content here, images, podcast and video from the Folger Shakespeare Library, with whom we've been working closely on this project, and also from actors from the London stage with whom we commissioned a full text audio of the play that you can play.
I am touched with anger so distempered.
You do look, my son, in a moved sort, as if you were dismayed. Be cheerful, sir. Our revels now are ended. These, our actors, as I foretold you, were all spirits, and are melted into air, into thin air.
So that's Dale Rapley on Prospero, who's seeing Prospero as really anxious at this moment when the mass gets interrupted, and nervous, and wanting to rush to resolve it. But we read Prospero a little bit differently.
You do look, my son, in a moved sort, as if you were dismayed. Be cheerful, sir. Our revels now are ended. These, our actors, as I foretold you, were all spirits, and are melted into air, into thin air.
So far sadder, more melancholy, more reflective. One of the exciting things about designing an app like this is that you get to make it multivocal, both in terms of the commentaries. This is not a single editorial vision of the play. And in terms of the voices that can be heard. We've also commissioned wonderful duets from Joseph Roche and Marge Garber, two very prominent Shakespeareans, taking two sides and flipping sides of a number of dialogues, Ferdinand and Miranda, Prospero and Ariel. So this is, I think, the kind of experimentation that one can do when the genres of publication are really unstable. The flip side of the instability that makes many of us feel anxious is the opportunity, the invitation, to think about designing new genres for knowledge and for communication. I'll let you guys play around with this after if you like. It's incredibly fun to play with. The team that designed this is about a dozen scholars, actors, and teachers, and software developers. And it's the vision of an ebook that we wish that we had. Our larger ambition is to make this platform available to other groups of scholars. When we show it to other scholars, they immediately say, I'd like to do Paradise Lost. How about Verdi's operas? And it would be relatively easy, now that it's built, to flip to new content. So I invite you to come talk to me if you get the bug or yen for something like that. One of the great lessons of doing this project for me has been to be disabused of stereotypes about the different ways that we work across the humanities and in computer science. What I've learned is that software developers are wordsmiths, and that my skills as a literary scholar in very precise statements about how texts operate and how readers and writers work with texts are exactly the skills that the software developers also care about. I've never worked with a team so precise as our development teams in the way they describe how readers and writers work. So it's been a tremendously exciting to discover in my literary skills a new scope of action. I think that's all I'm going to say now. It's now, I think, time to ask you guys what you want to talk about in response to the three of us, and then to hand it back over.
Please join me in thanking our speakers for... And I'd first like to invite the three of you to comment on each other, if you will. If you have any just immediate reactions or questions, and then we will see where that takes us on the audience.
I mean, I would echo the same experience of working with
folks who I think we've been led to believe work very differently than we do. Like I you know, obviously continue to learn a great deal from scholars in my field, but in the past decade I've learned at least as much from graphic and visual designers, from interactive designers, from software programmers, and we have sets of really shared concerns, and I think the university structures we inhabit make it harder for us to see our connections to colleagues in any other discipline, but particularly in kind of more technologically driven disciplines.
I would agree with that, and I would agree that, I mean, in the shift that we went through in the process of developing Media Commons, from thinking about a digital scholarly press, which was going to continue turning out texts by individual scholars, to instead thinking about the network, we were really trying to think through what new ways scholars were going to be working in going forward. And it's clear from everything that both of you have said, and from our experience as well, that the core of that process is now collaborative. That conversations, whether they're across clusters of scholars who are working on the same object, or with scholars and designers, scholars and developers, and scholars and students. I mean, these conversations are really at the core of everything that we're doing in the humanities right now.
So one of the questions we opened up with to sort of get people thinking was, where do humanists have the most scope for action? Do you think that's even a well-phrased question? Do you think about in your work needing to break new ground, or needing to move the field forward in terms of thinking of what is scope for action in the digital environment as a humanist?
Take a shot at that. I do. I mean, I think one of the things that's interesting here is that all three of us have talked about new modes of publication. And what we have as academics is a freedom that most publishers do not have, which is that we are not trailing existing businesses that are really struggling to be viable now. And that gives us extraordinary opportunity to be bold and to experiment in a way that many much of scholarly publishing right now really feels constrained in doing, except in a cautious way, because they're maintaining people's jobs and also commitments to keep knowledge going in the understanding that we don't know what's going to make that successful, right? Keep knowledge communicable without knowing what's going to make that successful. So we can take risks, it seems to me. We don't often think of ourselves as risk takers, as humanists, but
I think one of the things that we're at risk of losing is more and more information and the practices around knowledge sharing go online. Is there certain ways that digital platforms can erase context? So it's easy to kind of lose track of where you've
yes.
been as you move through spaces. You know, somebody might, you know, even on a kind of social platform like Pinterest, right, you know, the thing somebody's pinned within 6 hours no longer links to anything active, right? So you sort of lose the trail, the kind of rich web of history and context that surrounds, you know, kind of an object, right? And I think we have particular skill sets as humanities scholars in providing rich histories and context, as well as forms of narrative, right? So I think the digital environments will be very impoverished if the skill sets humanities scholars and thinkers have cultivated over time are not richly embedded in that environment.
The only thing that I would add to that is to say that one of the areas of potential action for humanities scholars today, I think, and an absolutely crucial one for many of us in our various fields and in our various institutions, is a sort of re-engagement with the public that has gotten lost in the last century in higher education. The kinds of projects that all of us are working on right now are demonstrating through models of opening up dialogue across the barriers between the academy and the broader interested public, that there is actually an interested public out there. And in opening those lines of communication, we can begin to demonstrate not just to our colleagues why that public matters to the work that we're doing, but also to the public why the work that we as scholars are doing matters moving into the 21st century, what kinds of modes of understanding this media change we have to bring that might better support all of our conversations about new forms of communication.
So given that, do you then advise, one of the questions that the three of you also posed as we were planning this session today is, what then is the future of the humanities major? And do you see advising people to stay in academia, to move out into more public modes of communication? And do you see academia changing to accommodate new forms of communication? That's sort of a double-barreled question.
I'm going to start. I'll say what I said earlier today, that it seems to me there's never been a better time to be an English major or a media studies major. In other words, what Tara just said about the urgency of the traditional modes of knowledge that we have now in digital media, our ability to create semi-permeable environments for learning and thinking and reflecting that are open but still constrained in ways that are productive. That skill set is tremendously valuable, and everybody navigating an online world knows it. Under our hands, our modes of reading and writing are changing right now, and it's the English major that studies the history of reading and writing. So the knowledge you get from a Victorian novels class or a medieval lit class is knowledge you can directly apply to your experience of reading in new forms. It teaches you to think comparatively and agnostically about media change rather than in a knee-jerk way. The knowledge that you get in a media studies major of how to communicate in multimedia formats is urgently important right now as argument and play and reflection moves into multimedia formats. So I think we have a tremendous opportunity to communicate that, and we ought, all of us, to be saying it to parents, employers, and students.
And I wouldn't want to see the question as should you be an academic or not, but to think about what the kind of porous nature is between what we do in the academy and spaces outside of the academy, so that collaborations between scholars and outside groups, I think it's incredibly interesting to have, you know, an English professor as entrepreneur, right? You know, like these kind of models that are hybrid, I think we're desperately in need of. Like I want people well-versed in, you know, from my own fields, post-structuralist theory, designing database software, right? Because I think that's going to be a different kind of database than the ones I hate to use right now, right? So, I mean, I think there are a lot of kind of both and scenarios we could explore as we move forward. I mean, we're at USC right now engaging that sort of dreaded process of rethinking the general education requirements, and the new version are going to look really different than what we do right now, but it doesn't mean we don't value some of the core kind of modes of thinking that the older forms cultivated, but I think we could now imagine GEs that aren't quite so disciplinary as some of them are in the present.
Mm-hmm. One of the things that we're doing, the MLA variant of rethinking the GEs right now, is that we've just launched a new task force on the future of graduate education in language and literature fields that is attempting to think through what it is to prepare PhD candidates today, not for the jobs that we have long expected them to have, i.e. jobs that replicate ours, but instead the jobs that they're actually likely to have when they graduate, jobs in a range of institutions that's much broader than simply the R1, jobs that involve both teaching and administration, jobs that involve a lot more technology, jobs that involve a different level of engagement with the public than what we've seen before. And so we're in the process. I mean, this task force is just beginning its work. It's being led by Russell Berman, our immediate past president of the MLA. And it's really beginning to engage with thinking about what the function of doctoral education is and how we can better prepare students for the world they're actually going to be moving out into.
So opening it up to anybody in the audience, questions about?
This event today is taking place in our library.
Mm-hmm.
And as a librarian, among many other librarians here today, we're always rushing to keep up with you in ways that are intended to support your work by providing a number of things that I think you're in the process of creating new ways of thinking and new ways of doing research. You're also challenging us to come up with new ways of allowing later scholars to retrace your steps. These
yes.
associative trails that Vannevar Bush once talked about. Problems that we have to do with the disappearing fixity of text, which is not only important to you, I think it's constitutional to the way that you proceed. Creativity changes things very rapidly, and our thought morphs over a span of seconds and minutes. I ask you, do you have any advice for us, what we can do to help over geography and over spans of time others in different times and in different places recreate what you are doing?
It's a very big question, and not one that I feel entirely qualified to take on, because as much as you say that you feel like you're, you know, working to keep up with us, frankly, I feel like scholars are in many ways far behind you guys in terms of thinking about questions of what the future of knowledge dissemination is going to be, and particularly in terms of thinking about the preservation of the kinds of digital scholarship that's being produced today. And so, I mean, I think the one of the most crucial roles that I see being played by libraries as we're moving further and further into the 21st century is that the library is no longer just a place where sort of knowledge gets collected and brought into the institution, but it's also becoming this sort of pivot point of knowledge. It's also the place where knowledge is being disseminated from the institution. As libraries increasingly become the centers of scholarly communication and publishing on campuses. And so the more that, and this is something that I harangue people about all the time as they're starting out new digital projects, the more that scholars work with the library on the front end of planning a digital project, of planning a new archive, of planning whatever the conglomeration of texts that they're going to be working with is, the more likely it is that preservation will be planned as part of the production of the work, not simply just having the work kind of dumped in your lap when we're done with it and say, now take care of this for the rest of its useful lifespan, please.
And after.
Right. Yeah. Exactly. So, I think the most important thing that you guys can do is to constantly remind scholars that as they're doing this digital work, they need to be working with you first. Not after it's done.
Did you pay her to say this?
Well, I mean, there's so many places where libraries are so far out ahead, right? You know, so like the Scholars Lab at the University of Virginia, which is actually really driving pedagogy at both the undergraduate and digital level for that institution. You know, the MPUB kind of experiments at University of Michigan now, where the press and the library are really thinking of themselves as partners and, you know, not competitors. I mean, I think one of the most interesting things developing on the library front right now is what economies of scale libraries might share, rather than each institution having to provide everything on their own all over again. I mean, it's a real problem, I think, with R1s in particular, our kind of reputation-based territoriality is, you know, each department wants to have the best of everything in each library, and in reality, with the kind of digital platforms that will be emerging, there's no reason why a set of R1s couldn't collaborate around a really rich infrastructure that's shared, rather than each person in each space and each institution having to invent it wholesale.
I guess I'd add two things to that. One is that it seems to me that faculty also need to recognize that changing role of librarians as partners, potentially in teaching and research. We have seen the work of the library as support, background support, right?
and it's now the place where the most significant action is. The expertise that's required, I mean, librarians are experts in living with media change and thinking ahead and backwards, and that seems to me unlikely to stop. In other words, I don't think we're going to settle on some platforms, three platforms, right,
yeah,
for the book, in the near future. And so what you will be doing is managing ongoing media change and multiple platforms and five or six generations of book users and form factors for the foreseeable future. And so that's an extraordinary charge. But it also means that it's in librarians that we're going to see, it's from librarians that we're going to be hearing the most urgent kinds of warnings and opportunities about that change. And we are looking to you for that as colleagues, not just as support staff.
And I think another place where that kind of changing landscape is really interesting is in the increasing porous borders between librarians and archivists,
mm,
right? That, you know, the functions of the archivist and the librarian, you know, 10 years ago even were quite distinct,
mm-hmm,
right? And, you know, one was meant to kind of share and make open, and the other was meant to hoard and protect, right? And I think, you know, those different sensibilities no longer hold for either group, right? And that shift opens up, I think, all sorts of interesting possibility. Yeah.
Yes, Holly.
Hi, if I may. Listening to the three of you this afternoon, it occurred to me that I'm now completely persuaded about more supple and effective ways to communicate between the professoriate and various parts of the student body, between and amongst professors in different programs and disciplines in the same university, between and amongst students and professors between different universities and scholarly communities elsewhere. I got all that. I can see the network. I'm there. But one of the things that came up this afternoon was about the way in which these more flexible, inventive, supple communication systems, qua publication technologies and so forth, could also bring about a new kind and a great uptick in the intensity of communication between, if you don't mind, us and non-academic audiences elsewhere. And I realize that that's the part that I don't know that I understand that. I don't see how that's working or how you're imagining that kind of communication taking place in this exceptionally brave new world.
There are just a couple of things that I'll point to fairly quickly. In several of the open review experiments that we've done at Media Commons Press, in these experiments we've opened different kinds of scholarly texts for what we think of as peer-to-peer review, open peer review process taking place through dialogue within the borders of the text online. In several of these different experiments, we've found that extremely interested, extremely knowledgeable non-academics have participated to great effect in these processes and had really important contributions to make. In my own case, the case of planned obsolescence, when we posted the manuscript, I got comments from a number of librarians, of course, who were able to respond to the parts of the text that had to do with issues directly related to the library. And these were, of course, folks who would never have been called upon in a traditional peer review process. But even beyond that, you know, I had an IP attorney leave comments on the portion of the text where I was talking about copyright. And this, he had come across this just through some network of links that I would hesitate to go back and attempt to recast, but he got interested in the ideas that were there and actually made a really key contribution to the text in that spot. Similarly, in the open review experiment that we did with Shakespeare Quarterly, there was an article that was focused on the use of video in a class teaching a particular Shakespeare text and the ways that these videos were able to help students get at certain kinds of meaning within the text.
And a filmmaker who had worked on Shakespeare, you will remind me if I'm correct about
John
that.
Wise.
Right, appeared and commented in a way that was extremely useful to the author of this article, and in a way that really kind of produced a much better understanding of what was happening on both sides of this equation. And so I think that simply in getting these texts out into open circulation and recognizing that there may not be the biggest audience out there in the public for the kind of work that we're doing, but there's certainly more audience than we have given credit for being interested in the kinds of texts that we take on, the kinds of media that we work with, the kinds of questions that we're exploring. Some of the public is our former students who are interested in maintaining a connection with the kinds of work that they've done while they were in our institutions, even after they leave. I think we have a real rich potential to convey to a much broader public than we currently do what it is that we're up to and why.
And I think if the boundaries, say, between a librarian and an archivist are more porous now, I mean, I'm not sure there were ever really boundaries between us and them, right? There are many us's and many them. So, you know, the experiments, I think, also around open courseware now, where, you know, MIT and now many other universities have opened up, you know, the lectures from a course that, you know, you wouldn't imagine 50,000 people around the world would then dutifully work their way through, right? You know, like I sat next to a very wealthy, successful financial planner who explained to me how much he was enjoying the open course that he was listening to and engaging with around Joyce and Ulysses, right? And, you know, it was fascinating to think, you know, there are audiences everywhere we might not imagine. And one capacity of circulating this material in open forms is that we might find some of those audiences we didn't know about before.
I have just different kinds of anecdotal examples. I teach a course, a freshman seminar on the history of reading and writing technologies from Plato to the digital age, and somehow that got into the circuit in the local high schools. And I ended up kind of off and on consulting with the high school administrations, giving talks to parents and to the faculties about what it means to be preparing students to write and read in new media, particularly with a local school that had just started a one-to-one laptop project. What kind of curricular changes do you need to make around the presence of mobile devices in the classroom? Doing similar kinds of work with virtual theaters for a local Shakespeare theater company and thinking about the ways that they can use those virtual environments in their education programs. And so before I began working with digital media and thinking about the bridges between traditional Shakespeare scholar kinds of questions and the way my students live in online worlds, those invitations weren't coming my way at all. And those audiences weren't part of my audience. So I guess the last thing I'd say is we have an ongoing, off and on again, digital humanities working group among the undergrads at Bryn Mawr, Haverford, and Swarthmore. And the first year it started, we had a dad who kept coming, an intellectual property lawyer, who was really interested in the way that authorship is unfixing from online identity for his daughter's generation of students. So we spent a lot of time talking about sock puppet play, you know, when somebody steals your laptop and sends emails at you, or in a variety of other ways impersonates you, makes you a sock puppet online. And other changing parameters of authorship and authorial identity. And those with somebody living in a legal world where authorship really has a different kind of status, those conversations were really rich and challenging for all of us. So those are anecdotal examples, but I think the opportunities get scaled up by the number of people engaging thinking about the bridging activity of one's traditional expertise and the new modes of communication that we're all living in.
If I could just say, some of the most amazing things we've seen through various library projects I've been involved with have been the transnational ability to communicate with people we just couldn't communicate with before, and of course, they often are in countries where the resources for the actual materials are extremely poor. But with the internet and the kinds of communication, especially when it's not real-time communication, and so people who might not come to an event like this because of their English skills, when they have more time to consider this, are great communicators. And one of the best examples that in my previous experience, where at a university we digitized a large cache of early wax cylinder recordings from the late 19th and early 20th centuries, all pre-1923, of course, out of copyright. And all of these cylinder recordings were the original wax cylinders and all digitized, and mostly cataloged, except many of the cylinders were produced in the United States, but produced for the Chinese immigrant market in the early 20th centuries on the West Coast. And nobody recognized the music who were doing the cataloging, the labels were unrevealing, but we digitized all of the stuff and put it up on the internet with, of course, your standard web, please email us if you have questions, little comment box. And, you know, lo and behold, some weeks after the whole website went up with something like 7,000 or 8,000 digital recordings, all for free download, we got an email from a guy in China who was a collector in China of these wax cylinders, and he had the complete production list of what the company had made, like the Schwann catalog, if you will, of its day. We didn't know, we had not been able to find anything like that in the US. And this guy scans in his copy and sends the complete list, so we could then match the data. And I think there's many examples of these pockets of people in places around the world that did not previously have a way to engage all of its.
So I can add some data to this. Many of you probably know about the open access initiatives at a number of academic institutions, and we've been thinking about an open access resolution in the faculty at Bryn Mawr. So we've been doing research on whether open access archiving of scholarly publications in fact increases citations. Looking carefully at a work by a guy named Davis, I think it might be Peter Davis, first in 2006 and then a follow-up article in 2011, what he seems to show, looking specifically at scientific articles that are posted on open access, is that there is a significant increase in downloads of articles, but not citations. So what do you make of that? His conclusion is that the beneficiaries of open access publishing may not be the research community, which already has excellent access to expensive scientific literature, right? Because our home institutions pay for that access, but to communities of practice that consume but rarely contribute to the corpus of that literature and don't have subscription access. So that evidence so far suggests that there may be a significant population of readers, in this case at least for scientific literature, that isn't us. Right, that's not at well-funded institutions. You have a question, yes?
No, I just wanted to comment that study is very controversial. There are other studies actually that do show pretty significant citation
increases. Yeah, this is the 2011. Yeah. Yeah. And right, so we went to the most conservative rather than the most liberal of the conclusions about citation increase. But you're right, it's fair to say that there are other studies that show that it's more significant than that. But I think the most important thing to think about is where those downloads come from, mm-hmm. right? And not assume that it's all us who are reading our own stuff.
Maybe one more question and then we could break into informal conversation. Mary.
So it's interesting that Catherine has come and asked, because in Nebraska, one of the things that a historian named William Thomas was sort of worried about was the fact that just humanities scholars were making their way to the web and thinking about digital projects. The whole environment, there's a new technology change, and that is a move from the PC to mobile app, to mobile devices, and less use of the World Wide Web and all of its openness and interconnectedness. So in fact, that you know, the story of that lawyer finding your book through some mm-hmm. network doesn't happen if what you're mostly looking at are apps on your phone or your iPad. And so I was just wondering what, you know, if you had thoughts about that, because it's kind of ironic. I mean, this seems very cutting edge, and yet, you know, especially younger people, that's what they're on, they're
Yeah, it is quite ironic, particularly given that just a couple of years ago, not even that long ago, in fact, Google had basically made the decision that the rest of your computer was unnecessary, that you should do everything inside the browser, right? So that all communication would become browser-based, and we were moving increasingly toward that browser-based mode. Now there is this kind of segmentation between the computer becoming more browser-oriented and these mobile devices becoming more app-oriented and therefore more kind of fragmented. The only thing, I mean, I don't do futurology because I am 99% certain to be wrong, except with this prediction, which is that it will change again. Whatever it is we are building for when we think we're building for tomorrow, we're going to be building for something different in a year. And so the most important part of all of this digital work is really to be thinking about future-proofing this stuff, how it's going to migrate forward. Does it adhere to robust, open data standards that are going to be translatable into new forms? Because we're going to be moving into new forms, like it or not.
And I think it's another argument for why folks who care about these kind of questions should participate in the development of these kinds of new modes of reading and sharing. So there's apps and there are apps, right? And your app is not hermetically sealed, right? It opens out to the internet. It opens out to other communities of use, right? There's great commercial imperative to build, if you're a corporation, a hermetically sealed app.
Yes.
It's a discrete, contained experience that you can own and sell and nobody can do much with outside of its space.
Yeah.
One might look at Apple's recent iBook platform and make the same argument, right?
Indeed.
Some you have on your blog, right? And if we don't engage those platforms and say, no, we don't want closed, hermetically sealed, infinitely commercialized, monetized apps. We want apps that open out into communities of practice, to different knowledge, to remix and recirculation. We can build those apps, and you have.
And I would just thank you. I hardly need to say anything more. It's not an either or, it seems to me. So the web itself isn't by definition open. In fact, many publishers, and most publishers in my field, are going to walled garden models because they desperately need a way to monetize the sale of a text. We don't yet have a way outside of soft foundation money to figure out how to keep publishing sustainable and totally free at the same time. So it seems to me we need to fairly relentlessly continue to experiment with the models that are going to maximize openness and mashability and yet be sustainable. So I started out completely committed to a free app, and then discovered that it needed a media company to keep upgrading it with every release of the operating system. And that the circulation power, the potential circulation power, was tremendously exciting, but I didn't want it to be in the trash heap of unsustainable projects. So these are imperatives that push and pull against each other, and I think the key, I would echo Tara, the key thing is we need to get in and do that pushing and pulling, not let it just be done to us.
I think that's a wonderful way to sort of wrap up the end of a very productive day. I want to thank all of you. I want to especially thank our special guests, and invite everybody to remain with us and have a glass of wine and enjoy the rest of the afternoon. And please join me in thanking Catherine, Kathleen, and Catherine.